Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to this edition of Disability Viewpoints. We got a great show today. Nick Wilkie is our co-host. Nick, who is your guest going to be?
Today, my guest is Adrienne Wilcox. She is my friend and colleague that also works for the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living.
She is really cool.
You know, she is very cool. This is the first time she's been on the show.
I know it.
And she came on to talk about the PCA College Service Corps, where we are looking to hire college students at an incentive award rate. So we have people with disabilities in the community that, of course, need PCAs and supports to maintain their independence in the community. And this program specifically aims at hiring college students to help fill in those gaps and also maintain a rewarding opportunity with people with disabilities and to help people maintain their independence.
Well, that sounds really good to me. I was supposed to have a guest, but I don't. So we're going to do a nice year end on maybe really what might happen this next session, what you remember the highlights were of last session. So we'll cover all that and more next on Disability Viewpoints. Please stay tuned.
Welcome back. I'm your co-host this month, Nick Wilkie. With me today is my friend and colleague, Adrienne Wilcox. Adrienne, thank you for being on the show.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me.
I know this specific program we're going to talk about today, I've been trying to get you on for a little bit. So I'm excited to have you, and I'm excited to share some new material with our viewers. Can you tell us a little bit about the origins of the program?
Yeah, so I'm here today to talk about the PCA College Service Corps. And it is a pilot program that is out of the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living, where we both work, but where viewers might know that we both work. But yeah, this has been established for a little while, but recently we got some new funding from the state legislature, and so we have some renewed efforts and renewed coffers in order to do a little bit more programming.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. And as we know, funding for the work that we do is always, always important. Can you tell our viewers a little bit more about what makes the program so innovative?
Yeah. So, and we can talk, the PCA College Service Corps was born out of the fact that there's definitely a current crisis in PCA care in the state of Minnesota and across the nation. There are many people who need this kind of support in order to stay in their homes and stay a part of their vibrant communities. And unfortunately, there are not enough individuals who are interested in these positions. And we can understand that there's a plethora of reasons that that may be the case. But we want to avoid things like individuals having to move into facilities that they do not want to have to reside in. We want to avoid people having medical issues that are being unmet. We want to keep people, again, part of those communities where they're most comfortable and can do the best service for the rest of us. So an individual named Diane Drost spoke with people at the Margaret A. Cargill Foundation Fund, part of the St. Paul in Minnesota Foundation, and she procured an initial $500,000 grant in order to start this PCA College Service Corps to draw college students in to work as PCAs. So that's kind of the origins of this program.
Awesome. Awesome. And as you and I know, one of the coolest parts about working for a Center for Independent Living is the idea that we're doing everything we can every single day to remove barriers and promote the idea that people can make choices and remain independent for as long as possible. And as we think back to the origins of Centers for Independent Living, like without appropriate supports, people can't remain independent. in their own homes.
Right, and you are leading into something I actually wanted to touch on today, and that's the Ed Roberts, kind of the founder of the disability movement and of definitely one of the co-founders of Centers for Independent Living overall. He was kind of a renegade in this, in that did he go to college with all of those services in place, with formal PCAs in place? No. Mm-hmm. It was fellow college students that stepped up and made sure that he had the care that he needed. And so it is kind of the perfect situation that a Center for Independent Living is the one who is partnering in order to do this PCA College Service Corps. Yep. Because again, we're both innovating, but we're also going back to some supports that should be in place for anybody who would like to remain in the community.
Super cool. Maybe this is a good spot to talk about not only like the benefits of the program for the community, but what are the benefits for the hires?
Yeah, any student, so it does not have to be somebody who's pursuing specifically a four-year degree, but anyone who is currently enrolled in higher education can apply to be part of this program. They would be asked to work 10 hours a week as a PCA, and there are different lengths of time that an individual can work, but the longest period is 30 weeks that they would be involved in this program. And if that person dedicated 30 weeks to this endeavor and worked at least an average of those 10 hours a week with an individual needing PCA care, they would receive an additional $4,500 in bonuses, or as we call them, incentive bonus awards. And that's broken up over one third of the time. So the person would receive that in three different installments. So they wouldn't just have to wait until the end. But that incentive bonus award isn't a scholarship. It is not something where they can only spend that money for a limited number of things. It's just more money in their pocket in order to encourage them to participate in this kind of work that will change their lives and yep. change the lives of the people who they work with.
Well, and that's the thing that's so telling is that, you know, when you get an opportunity to step away from your own kind of space and help somebody else, and that's
right.
That's the reason I'm still doing the work that I'm doing.
Right, and there's a lot of people that I've spoken to through the course of this work and reaching out to different educators and other individuals who've said, you know, my employment in the disability community all started because I was a PCA, or it all started because of one moment that, you know, they were going to be a business analyst, and instead they've chosen to have a career in a totally different area because their eyes were open to a different part of the world that they maybe hadn't seen prior. And again, as students, we all know that education is more expensive than ever, and students need jobs, most people, in order to pay for life and right. whatnot. But
well, and I even think about those incentive bonuses, like, you know, what could you use that money for as you're trying to establish yourself being as independent as possible in the community?
Right.
I mean, there's all sorts of avenues, right?
Well, and isn't it nice to maybe go to a job that instead of getting paid, you know, the now $19 an hour is the new rate for PCAs in the state of Minnesota. So yep. we know that you can get paid $19 an hour to do a job elsewhere, but wouldn't you like to do a job where you're with an individual in their home, where you maybe have some more flexibility with your schedule, where that person is actively really excited to have you there
right.
and happy to see you each time? And also, you know, there's a wide variety of people with disabilities who need this kind of care. We specifically ask that participants be people who need more than 10 hours of PCA care a day and direct their own care. So that tends to be individuals who, you know, potentially they're working their own full-time jobs and
yep.
they need this support, but that might be a mentor in another line of service that somebody's interested in. These are people with full lives themselves,
right.
with plenty to educate about the world and just be another individual who might propel someone's career in another direction. And yeah.
Well, and like we said a little bit already, I mean, just imagine the impact and the relationship that you get over the course of time, you know, supporting these individuals.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you mentioned a little bit about this before, Adrienne, but I want to make sure that we highlight this. So it sounds like new funding has just been procured, and is that funding over the course of a year?
The legislature did pass in July that there was some additional funding that was going to be provided to this program, and that funding is set to expire in July of next year, so June 30th. So we are absolutely going to go back and ask the legislature for potentially more time and more funds in order to complete this program.
Cool.
As if somebody were to start tomorrow, that 30-week period would be very soon. So again, we have the ability to do that. We have a great relationship through, again, advocates like Diane Drost and our executive director, Jesse Bethke Gomez. We, you know, have a lot of opportunities to advocate with the legislature for the way to make this the most successful program possible.
Very, very cool. And I imagine that there's other opportunities to approach maybe other foundations.
Right, and as this takes off, you know, we will only have more and more of evidence that this is something that should be funded, as we're hoping to again meet a crisis in our state right now.
Yeah.
So,
well, and this is another good opportunity to say, disability is the one population we all become more of tomorrow.
Right.
So, you know, it's not only people that you know right now, but you know, like a handful of years from now, it could be more people.
Right. Disability will impact all of our lives at one time or another.
Yep.
And education and knowing more about it when you're if you're a traditional student, a young age, that can be a benefit for your entire life.
Yep. Just one more question that I had, Adrienne. Have there been programs like this in other states?
To our knowledge, this is definitely the first of its kind that provides that incentive bonus award that can be spent however the student PCA decides to spend. In Arizona, there was a pilot program that recruited 50 students in order to have scholarships. So it was a similar way to give an incentive for an individual to become a new PCA. But this is the first of its kind where the individual can choose to where to spend that money.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Mm-hmm. That's innovation in itself. And then what is the best way, that people can find out more?
Right. And you can go on to the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living website and scroll down to our programs, and you can see that there's a page specifically for the PCA College Service Corps. An individual would also be able to email me directly at pcacsc@mcil-mn.org. And I would be happy to send along the webpage, any flyers or promotional materials. Again, we're not just asking for student PCAs to sign up. We're also asking if you are a friend or family member of an educator, if you have a niece or nephew who's currently in school, if your mail carrier is in school, if your hairstylist wants to go back to school and, again, is looking for another way to earn a little bit of money while having a flexible job. And also, again, maybe be an important step in their career, that if they would be willing to do that, we want anyone to know more about this program, because word of mouth is definitely the way that we've seen this be the most effective, because it does seem too good to be true that we're literally just giving you $4,500 in order to work as a PCA.
Right. Well, Adrienne, this has been a wealth of information. I want to encourage people, go to MCIL's website, look for the link on the program. Anything else that you want to share today?
I just, again, want to encourage that we appreciate the funding that we've had so far, both through the Margaret A. Cargill Foundation. We appreciate continued support from our legislature, and everybody needs to know who their representatives are and encourage the programs that they think are best to support their communities. And yeah, we just are looking forward to this program exploding and meeting the need and meeting the crisis that's happening in our community now.
Super cool. Adrienne, thank you so much for coming on today, and I'll look forward to having you back.
Wonderful. Thanks, Nick.
No problem. All right. Disability Viewpoints will be back in just a few moments after these messages.
Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. We thought we would take this time to talk about the big wins last year at the legislative session and some of the changes we may see this legislation, even though we have a $2.4 billion surplus right now. Those numbers may change. How do I know that? I recently saw Senator John Marty, and they're going to talk about a few things this coming real soon. But one of the things that I would be concerned about with the surplus is down at Oak Park Heights, the Stillwater State Prison. And it's been on our local news. They're going to need a whole new air conditioning system. First of all, that place is big, it's old, and I can see getting a bid on it, and then the cost overage running over and dipping into the surplus to do that. And there are other programs, too, such as we raised the sales tax 1.38, and we talk about affordable housing, which is much needed. They've had places and committees in Minneapolis that have met with Mayor Fry to talk about mini housing because the shorting housing crisis has been so short. So these things we see. So what did we have for wins last session? Well, Rep. Kelly Moeller was really sharp and put together an enhanced Metro Mobility Tax Cap program whereby now you can call, give them your Metro number, and you get an airport cab with a lift-equipped van on it if you need it. And once they quit telling you that they don't have the vans after 5 o'clock, and they really do because they're under contract, you'll get one. And you'll get a reduced fare. Like from White Bear Lake to Shoreview, you pay $5. The Metropolitan Council pays some of the rest, and they have different reduced fares. I think it's $20 or $22 to get down to Eagan. So you have to, once you give your address and where you're going, they should tell you what the customer is going to pay for the fare, but it's really reduced. And it's been a good program. It's been on time. You only got room for one wheelchair in there, so you're saving time. And it's a 2-year pilot project that we have, and it's really worked out well. And more and more of the communities are using it. Cottage Grove is getting it or does have it, and so it's expanding a little bit. So, Nick, those are my top two. What do you see on your?
So I'm just thinking back to some of my guests that I've had in this year, and we kicked off the year with having my friend and colleague come in to be so Rowan. He works as the community liaison for the Disability Hub, mm-hmm. Talking about them hitting the ground and going to information fairs to get more information out about how the hub helps people in the community, how it's the statewide resource that people can gather information and resources about how they can increase their independence. Also thinking back about, one of my more recent guests, in terms of Rec and Leisure, Mark.
Rec and Leisure, what's that?
Being able to get out in the community and ride my pedal bike in ways that I hadn't been able to do until I got it.
Is that your Can-Am?
That's not the motorcycle, Mark.
Oh.
This is the
hand-pedaled
model.
That's right.
So I had my friend Ron come in, and he operates GB Kids.
Yeah.
And what he does is he makes He modifies and sells adapted bikes for people with disabilities so they can get out in the community and participate with their friends and loved ones. And I got connected with him because I wanted to get power assist on my hand powered bike.
Then you bought a bike.
Well, so I bought the bike, and then afterwards, because I live in St. Paul and St. Paul is not flat, I needed the
Seven
power
Hills,
assist.
As Jesse Ventura used
right.
to call it.
Yes, I needed the power assist to be able to keep up with my loved ones, and that's really
so.
Made
let's
a difference.
See, a new car, a Can-Am, a bike. You must have to build a pole building.
Oh, I don't have enough outdoor storage, Mark. But that's for another episode.
Yeah.
But overall, I think it's a continuing pleasure to be part of the show. I love being able to highlight
it is.
Really, really good things in our community, and also making sure that our community is aware of the ways that we're still trying to push that envelope and
absolutely.
And, increase better access and better
yep.
better independence for people.
Another memory that I have from this year is Access Press. They had a nice dinner.
Well, they did.
And they really honored Tim Benjamin. It was over at the McNamara Center over at the University of Minnesota. What a great night.
It was great.
And had a lot of fun. It was dark when I got there and darker when I went home. But
that's true.
Had a good time.
But the thing I'd say about that, Mark, is the thing that I really enjoyed about that evening is that it was the first time in a long time that a lot of people in the disability community got together and celebrate our
Yeah, that was our night. You know, that was really our night.
It was really cool.
It was really cool. And we got about 5 minutes left, so we can share another couple of memories. Do you have another memory this year?
I've always got more memories.
It was our 25th anniversary on this show.
Right.
And that was pretty good in October, so that was a milestone for a lot of us.
Mark, did we get another hometown award?
No, we tried though. Steve Brunsberg really tried, and he's gonna. Matter of fact, coming up in 2024, I would imagine, as quiet as Steve is, he'll apply again for us.
Okay.
And see if we can get that. I don't know where it is, but we might have to go.
All right. The other thing that I was thinking about in terms of upcoming, I know that it's coming up here in January is Ed Roberts' birthday. And as you know, Ed Roberts is one of the founders of the independent living movement.
Yeah.
And the organization I work for, Center for Independent Living, was
Metropolitan Center for Independent
Yes, Metropolitan Center for
you
Independent
Living. You see how I did that?
Yes. Not Minnesota Center.
I stayed up all night in practice.
You did. Our Center for Independent Living was started about 10 years after Ed Roberts started the first Center for Independent Living in California.
So how many years is that, do you know?
So they're celebrating, Berkeley is celebrating their 50th anniversary.
You're at 40.
And I believe our center is going to celebrate their 40th
anniversary.
Yeah,
but you got a nice building.
It is a nice building. Yeah. I look forward to seeing more activity in that building.
Absolutely,
know?
Absolutely.
That would be a good thing too.
So all in all, it's been a really good year.
I think so.
And I'm wondering if I do the final word segment. I'm going to give you the final word.
You have it? You want to give me the final word?
Absolutely. We can be here till 6.
All this pressure. But I want to thank obviously Disability Viewpoints, the staff, our producer Joe, Mark. You're gracious enough to let me co-host occasionally.
You
it's
do
a great
fine.
Time.
You know you carry the show to number one, so why wouldn't I?
Thank you. Compliments all around.
All right.
Disability Viewpoints will be back after these short messages. Thanks again for tuning in.
Amen. But anyway, we're gonna omit that and just go on to a close. So anyway, once again, it has been a good year. I thank SPNN and Steve Brunsberg and Terry and my whole crew for all that they do and putting up with me as many times as we do this and as many times we have to fix things and add things on. They've been more than gracious. Joe Urbis, who is kind of my right hand and puts up with a lot. But I thank the viewers at home, because without you, there isn't any input on what to really do with the show or the businesses that affect it, such as Metropolitan Center for Independent Living. Without those are kind of the ingredients that go into it. And Joan Wilshire and a few others that co-host that give us these ideas. And it's not just me, it's a collaborative show. Everybody has a say in it, and that's what I kind of want to do. And if something happens that it has to go on without me, that's what I'd want. So it's up to you, the viewers at home. It's up to the people here. Appreciate it very much. Thanks for watching. I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for a great year, and we'll see you in 2024. Bye now.
A lawyer, a teacher, a warehouse worker, a fitness instructor, a software engineer. What do all these people have in common? Well, they are all Minnesotans who are blind, deafblind, or visually impaired, heading to their jobs every day.
State Services for the Blind, or SSB, helps blind, deafblind, and visually impaired Minnesotans create a path to reach their career and employment goals. That might mean learning the skills of living well with vision loss, getting training in technology, developing a resume, finding an open position, or working with an employer to figure out some job accommodations.
At SSB, customers set their career goals, and we provide training and resources to help Minnesotans achieve those goals.
An accountant, a baker, an office manager, a small business owner, a customer service rep, an architect, blind, deafblind, and visually impaired Minnesotans are hard at work in all these careers and lots more too.
If you have vision loss and are looking for work or looking to advance in your career, just give us a call at 651-539-2300 or visit mnssb.org. State Services for the Blind, Independence, Equality, Opportunity, Achievement.
Well, that's our show for today. I want to thank Nick Wilkie from Metropolitan Center for Independent Living for being here and his special guest. There was her first time on TV. She did great. She'll probably win an Emmy. And Nick, what did you think of the show?
I really enjoyed our show today, Mark. Just the opportunity to have Adrienne come on and highlight, the PCA Service Corps and what a helpful program this is going to be for our community and for the hires that are looking to fill that need.
Before we go, we want to remind people that in February, the next legislative session will really start. And so we want to remind people that they will probably have Tuesdays at the Capitol again. And so to look forward to announcements and different things that you can help lobby for that the disabled community really needs. So please stay tuned to the show, and we'll try to tell you all about it. Nick Wilcano be down there as we always are every year, so stay tuned for that information. And thanks for watching the show. We'll see you next time on Disability Viewpoints. Bye for now.